Welcome to Season 4 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to current topics in public health through engaging interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon brings Johns Hopkins epidemiologist Dr. Chris Beyrer back to the podcast, this time to talk about a difficult milestone, the 40th anniversary of the HIV/AIDS epidemic. They discuss the lessons that have been learned and not learned since then, and what they mean in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. Let's listen.
Chris Beyrer, thanks so much for joining me.
Wonderful to be here, Stephanie.
Today, I'd like to talk to you about the 40th anniversary of the first report of AIDS in the United States. You've recently published a piece in Science called The Work Undone. Could you tell me about that?
Yeah. So, you know, it's an extraordinary anniversary. This was June 5th, 1981. The CDC puts out, of course, the MMWR, the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report. And so this was a report of a cluster, five cases of a rare pneumonia in previously healthy, as they said then, homosexual men, young, healthy gay men with pneumocystis pneumonia. And two of the five died, and all of them had advanced immunocompromise. So that was the beginning. That was the first recognition. Now, in retrospect, of course, we know that the virus had been circulating for a number of years, that there already were many tens of thousands of people infected all over the world, but nobody had really seen it until this cluster. And so I was asked to think about where we are in the United States 40 years on. And where we are is really challenging, and it is still it's still the AIDS pandemic. It is not over. So we have over 1.2 million people living with HIV in this country. The data that the CDC most recently put out, and this was what I was really referring to, is not from 2020, because that data is still being analyzed. And 2020 will be an outlier year for everything. It's a COVID year. But the CDC was reporting on the 2019 data. So between 2018 and 2019, there was only about an 8% decline in new infections. So that is not enough to achieve our targets. But also, the geography of AIDS has changed. So it started out as a bi-coastal epidemic, you know, California, New York, Miami, Los Angeles. But now, the most affected areas and the highest rates of new infection are in a big swath of the Southeast that basically goes from Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida, Georgia, the Carolinas, and up to Baltimore. So that used to be called the Cotton Belt. Then it was called the Syphilis Belt. Now it's the HIV Belt. And it is also the map, of course, of American slavery. But it's also the map of where red state governors refused to expand Medicaid through the Affordable Care Act. And it is the map of underinsurance in this country. And the problem is, you know, that we still have a work-based insurance system where most people get their health insurance through their job, but low-income people are squeezed out of that because they have jobs that don't have good benefits. And on the other hand, they're not poor enough to qualify for Medicaid. So you have a huge number of low-income working poor and working class Americans in the Deep South, predominantly African American, but also Latinx. And that is where the HIV epidemic is concentrated. And the health disparity is just extraordinary. It's 8 times the prevalence in Black Americans compared to white, and 4 times the prevalence in Latinx Americans compared to white.
Those are sort of staggering numbers. I wanted to talk a little about, again, about sort of the beginning of this AIDS epidemic. I guess not even the beginning. I mean, we're in a different pandemic right now, right, with COVID-19. And we, you know, quickly we had some treatments. And within a year, we had highly effective vaccines, right, that could be given to millions and millions of people. But that was not the case with HIV. What took so long?
Well, remember that it's still taking too long, and we're still not there yet. So we've been trying, working on HIV vaccines for more than 30 years, and we still don't have a vaccine. The treatment issues, the antivirals, I think it's very important to remember that when HIV emerged in the early 80s, there were no antiviral drugs essentially for any viral infection, except one not very effective drug for herpes and one not very effective drug for flu. The era of antiviral drugs that are effective and work against viral infections, not bacteria, not antibiotics, but antivirals, is because of AIDS. It was because of that intense amount of research. And it took 15 years. So from that emergence in 1981 until the first effective therapy, which was triple therapy, was 1996. So there were 15 years without effective therapy, and millions of people lost their lives. And the reason for that is because it was such a huge effort to develop antivirals. It turns out that coronavirus is actually quite an easy virus to make a vaccine against because of the corona, because of the spike protein. It actually has a very clear target. HIV, of course, is a different class of virus. It's a retrovirus that actually inserts into our genome, and it does so by infecting immune cells, white blood cells. So it undermines the immune response. So I'll give you another example. When you have an antibody test for COVID and you test positive, it means you've either had COVID or you've had a vaccine, right? And by the way, if you've had a vaccine and are protected, you're kind of good to go. And of course, the majority of people who get COVID, the great majority, recover spontaneously and clear the virus. HIV, we've had one person out of 84 million infections who has managed to clear the virus. And that is because of two bone marrow transplants. So if you have antibody to HIV, that means you are infected. And before the treatment era, it meant essentially all those people were going to die. So it's a very, very different foe. It's also, of course, way much less infectious. And it really requires intimate contact, sex, birth, breastfeeding. Unlike COVID, which, you know, you can get from talking to somebody, riding the bus, going to summer camp.
Was stigma part of this, do you think?
Oh, there's no question. There's no question. And it is remained an intractable problem. So, you know, when HIV emerged in that cluster initially of gay men, it was unfortunately a quite conservative time in the country. Ronald Reagan was president. It was still very, very common to just espouse anti-gay language and rhetoric. And of course, there was nothing like marriage equality, and LGBT people did not have full rights in this country. And if you go back and listen to the first press conference, the White House press conference on AIDS, they literally, the aides are joking and teasing each other, because why would anybody be worried about having this unless you were a homosexual? And it's just kind of gay bashing and gay jokes. It's disgusting, because it already was in the thousands of people. And they sort of note that about, you know, 2 in 5 people with this disease die. And those were Americans they were talking about. And it's just absolutely dismissive. During that time, you know, I was a medical student. It became clear that there were other people also at very high risk. Of course, people who inject drugs and through needle sharing, needle syringe exchange. And then it emerged that there were heterosexuals all over the world, and that it was transmitted from mother to child in pregnancy and through breastfeeding. But that early association with stigma and homophobia never really went away. And of course, now it continues because in the United States, when you look again at that new data, the 2019 data, more than 2/3 of all new infections are in gay and bisexual men. We now have an incredibly concentrated epidemic. And of course, it is even more predominantly among men who have sex with men, gay and bi men of color, Black and Latinx. And, you know, I don't have to tell you that in the Deep South and in these more conservative parts of the country and red state legislatures, it is very tough to be gay in many of these places, and it is very tough to be Black and gay.
So in many quarters currently, HIV and AIDS are seen as treatable chronic conditions. But that's not true everywhere, is it?
No. First of all, you know, the fact that something is treatable and chronic doesn't make it not a problem. So, you know, diabetes is chronic and treatable, and it still kills a lot of people.
Indeed.
And it's a very tough disease. So, you know, when I started, when I was a medical student, the life expectancy of somebody with AIDS was 6 months. It's now 72 years.
Wow.
So that is a sea change. That is a revolution. And that's antiviral therapy. And it's a huge achievement. But those folks now are aging with a chronic disease. That means, and there's accelerated aging associated with HIV and with being on those early drugs. And there are just a range of complications, metabolic complications, diabetes, heart disease, dementia, mental complications, osteoporosis. It's a long, long list. And the one that is really killing people, which is HIV-associated cancers, which we really can't do that much about. So most of the people that I've known, patients who've died in the last decade, have died because they got an HIV-associated cancer on top of their HIV, even if it was well-treated. But what we have, unfortunately, is still about 2/5 or so of people living with HIV worldwide are not on therapy. And we have many, many subpopulations that are really undertreated. One of the most painful is children. There's an enormous gap in children being able to access treatment. And they're actually pediatric cases under age 12 are the least treated of all populations. And that's just something we really have to fix. We are still seeing very high rates of new infection in women and girls, particularly in East and Southern Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa. So that globally now is the most affected region. But amazingly enough, HIV is still expanding in two regions. So the epidemic is still out of control in two regions. One is Eastern Europe and Central Asia. Most of that is driven by Russia, which has an out-of-control epidemic of COVID too, by the way. And the other is the Middle East and North Africa, where the rates are low, but the epidemic is in expansion mode. And that is in very stigmatized populations. The Middle East is, of course, a very conservative part of the world, many conservative societies, and HIV there is among, again, gay and bisexual men, drug users, sex workers, and those societies have had a very hard time dealing with it.
What lessons would you say we've learned from HIV and AIDS that can be carried over to other pandemics, I guess, considering even the one we have now?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think the first thing we've learned is that the investments in science really pay off. So, you know, this messenger RNA technology, for example, that's behind the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines, that was not developed for COVID. That has been under development for two decades, right? For other diseases. In fact, people have been working on mRNA for Ebola, another emerging infection, for dengue. And it turned out that we were able to very quickly pivot and start to, and for the first SARS, I should say as well. So those investments in science really paid off. And it's also true that remdesivir, the first antiviral for COVID, is very much out of the same sort of family and class of antiviral drugs as the ones for HIV. So the investments in science really pay off. The second big lesson I'm afraid we haven't learned yet, and it's still very painful, and that is that once we had triple therapy in 1996, there was a long, slow wait for most of the world. We did not really commit to treatment for the rest of the world, particularly Africa and Asia, until 2003 with the PEPFAR program. And it didn't really get off the ground until 2005. So that was almost another decade where people in the West and the United States, Europe were living and going back to work and school and parenting, and people in the rest of the world were still dying. So what changed that was a huge activist battle to make the drugs more available, cheaper, to do manufacturing in developing countries. So India became a manufacturer, South Africa, Thailand, Brazil. And we took on the pharma companies and the World Trade Organization. And by the way, the US administration at the time, which was not supportive. Poor Al Gore was the person who was tasked with supporting pharma. And when he was running for president, he never went anywhere without AIDS activists showing up and saying, stop this, allow intellectual property law to be waived. People are dying. And it worked. So right now, you know, we still pay about $22,000 a year for antiviral therapy per patient in the US. And the cost in South Africa is $50 a year. So that fight is now underway with COVID. We have got to immunize the whole planet. It is not going to be enough to protect America and Western Europe and Australia and a few other places and the athletes going to the Olympics. We are going to lose this fight if we can't immunize planet Earth against this virus because of the variants. These variants are emerging. And they're more infectious. They may be more lethal. And, you know, we are, in this case, truly one human species. And we're up against a very, very hyper-mutatable pathogen right now.
Chris Beyrer, thank you so much for your perspective.
Thank you, Stephanie. It's always a pleasure talking with you.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holz Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.